In the last class on Wednesday, one of the things that we were considering towards the end of the class was what happens to the delay, for example, if I consider a gate such as a two-input NAND gate. Right? So let's just look at the problem that arises a bit more carefully. What we have is a two-input NAND gate. Okay? The transistor level structure looks like this. Which means that during the pull down phase, right, that is to say when A and B are both equal to 1, the pull down circuit looks something like this. With both switches being closed. Okay? Now the question is, over here of course you have the external load capacitance. Apart from that, what we assumed was over here there is a certain parasitic capacitance, which is what we use for the computation of the parasitic effect. But the part that we left out was the fact that there is also some capacitance at this point. I'll call this node X. This is the capacitance at X. Okay? So it's an intermediate capacitance. It is the capacitance between the two transistors. Why does it exist? Because there is a drain to source, drain region as well as the drain region of the lower transistor, source region of the upper transistor. That is the diffusion area. Right? An N plus diffusion area. Which means that by definition it has to act as some kind of a capacitance. Okay. How big is this capacitance? What we said was it ultimately depends on the layout. It depends on how well you have done the layout. It depends on how much is the area of intersection between the source and the drain. But typically, given that the size of the transistor would be 2 for these, right? We can assume that this T bar, we came up with this number, approximately 6 T. Right? 2, 2, 2 from the NMOS as well as from the 2 PMOS transistor. Tx, we are saying, can be taken to be 2 T. Right? That is to say, it is effectively as good as saying there is either one source region or one drain region corresponding to one size 2 NMOS transistor over there. You don't have two different regions. You don't have a source and a drain separately. They can be shared. Right, if the source and drain were separate, it would have been 2C plus 2C, 4C capacitance at this point. In reality, it would be a bit less than that because you don't really need to spend so much area on the shared source and drain region. Okay? So, this 2C of course is an approximation. The actual value depends on how you have done the layout. Right? Alright, so what impact does this have on our delay? Okay. First of all, does it have an impact on the delay? Do you think that it will cause the delay to change at all? Why? Because there is some additional capacitance, which means that that capacitance is in turn storing some charge. Let's say that output Y was equal to 1. It is high. Right? Output Y is high. Means that this node must also be high. Not necessary, of course, it depends on what the value of A is. But assuming that this node is also high, right? Both of these need to charge, or rather discharge. Okay? Which means that whatever current is flowing through the lower NMOS is discharging both the load capacitance and the load parasitic as well as the internal capacitance Cn. Okay? So, this at least gives us one good reason why we need to understand what the effect of these kind of capacitances is. Okay. So rather than trying to analyze it in the context of a transistor, let's take up a clean RC kind of a circuit and see what impact would be there on the delay for such a circuit. Okay. Let's consider first a simple RC. This is the input VI. This node is the output VO. Okay. What we are interested in is the output VO as a function of VI. Okay. So I am straight away going to go into the Laplace domain and write down in terms of impedances. VO, and I will leave out the by of S, if understood characters of S, okay. VO divided by 1 over ST, that is the current through the capacitor, is equal to VI divided by R plus 1 over ST. Right? Then you just equating the current at this node. So what does that mean? VO by VI equals 1 over 1 plus S T R. Okay? Now this is what leads to the e power minus T by RC term in the time domain. Okay? And this RC is the time constant corresponding to the delay. Okay? So effectively what we are saying is that the final time response in the time domain looks like some kind of an exponential, or I think exponential in this case. The time constant of that exponential is RC. The delay is finally going to be proportional to RC. Depending on how you define the delay, whether it is up to 0.5 of the final output or 0.1 to 0.9 or 0.2 to 0.8, it would be some constant times RC. As far as we are concerned, we are interested only in the RC itself, because that is what primarily determines our delay. Okay? So we take the RC itself to be the delay for this first order circuit. Okay? Let's consider something which is closer to the situation in the two input NAND gate. Two capacitances C1, C2, resistances R1 and R2. This is the input. In the case of the NAND gate, it's actually going to be discharging, which means that the input is effectively being set to 0. And whatever are the output capacitances are discharging. Okay? But even that can be treated as effectively, okay, you have charged capacitances, you are setting the input voltage source to be 0, so that is discharging. Okay. Or if you had a NOR gate, then you can consider exactly the circuit would look exactly like this. Right? Where there are two CMOS transistors in series and in turn driving the output load capacitor. Okay? This output terminal voltage we call VO and this intermediate terminal I'll call VA. Okay, the voltage there is VA. Okay? Let's try and derive VO by VA once again for this. So that the first step we can write down is VO by VA is going to be 1 over 1 plus ST2 R2. Right? Just similar to what it was in the previous case. For VS, we can essentially equate current set S, VI minus VX by R1 equals VO by 1 over ST2 plus VX over 1 over ST1. Right? Expand this out. right? Expand this further. Di by R1 equals Do by R1 times 1 plus h c2 r2 into 1 plus h c1 r1 plus this term h c2 gets multiplied by r1. Okay, this means do by di becomes 1 over 1 plus x into, I'll group all the terms corresponding to x, c2 r2 plus c1 r1 plus c2 r1 plus there is some term that is x square. Okay, c1 c2 r1 are the matter. The important point is this. Okay, what is the expression corresponding to the first order term in the result? That gives us our desired approximation for the delay. Right? Of course, the second order term also has effect on the final delay. But it's something that is going to be slightly less, or at least we can approximate it to be less. So our main concern is with the first order term, which is C1 R1 plus C2 R2 plus C2 R1. Okay? I'll rewrite that in a slightly different form. I'll call it tau equals R1 into C1 plus C2 plus R2 into C2. Okay, once again just redraw for convenience that picture over here. This is C2, R2, C1, R1. Okay, effectively what this is saying is the total time constant or the delay for this slightly more complex network is R1 multiplied by the total capacitance downstream of R1. Right? What do I mean by downstream? Further away from the source and towards the final destination. This is my source, Di. This is my final destination, Do. Okay? So you move away from source towards the final destination. You find out what are all the capacitances on the path that are there towards the final destination. Okay? You take R1 multiplied by that, R2 multiplied by its corresponding capacitances that are on the path, and that gives you your final time constant. Okay? Another way of writing this is to also say we have a source Di, we have a destination Do. For every capacitance, right, C1 and C2 in this case are only two capacitors, we consider the path which leads from the source up to that capacitance. And we also consider the path which leads from the source up to the final destination. Okay? So, this red line is the path leading from source to final destination. This blue line is the path leading from the source up to C1. Okay? The intersection between them, the common path, in this case is only R1. Okay? So for C1, I take R1 as the common path and multiply it. C1 into R1. Okay? For C2, from source to final destination is R1 and R2. From source up to C2 is also R1 and R2. It's the same because C2 is actually the final destination. Right? The common path between the two is R1 and R2. So I take C2 and multiply it by R1 plus R2. Okay? So there is this notion of path leading from the source to the destination and to each intermediate capacitance. And there is this notion of a shared path, something which lies both on the source to final destination as well as source to any individual capacitance. Okay? Those two paths exist. How many of the resistors are shared between them? Okay? So now, effectively what we have found is, for this sort of second order system, we have, yeah. Yes. So as it stands right now, the second capacitance has a greater influence on the gate, because it is being charged through a greater resistance. Okay. So effectively what you can think of it is, the second capacitance is farther away from the source. The path to it leads through a greater amount of resistance. So it is going to end up taking more time in order to charge, because lesser in whatever the RC value across that longer path is going to be the one determining that. The first capacitance is not relevant because only a part of the current which is charging the final destination is flowing into the first capacitance. Whatever current passes by the first capacitance and then goes to R2 has no further effect on R1, on C1. So it's not strictly speaking of the layer, second capacitance has a greater effect. It is more to do with the path that you are concerned with. Yes. No, it's not saying anything about this small transistor has greater effect or anything of the sort. Both of them have a resistance. There is an intermediate capacitance which is due to both of them. Right? All that this is saying is, the overall system taken as one block, what can you say about the propagation delay through it? It's not saying anything independently about either one of the MOS transistors. Although of course you could take this in order to, you know, if you wanted to try and tune the delay to the combination, you could try and modify the R1, R2 value for the MOS transistor. Okay? So, for this system, just 2R and 2C, right? We can see clearly that the first order term in the delay comes out to be this expression, which we have seen two ways of interpreting it. Either we can think of each resistance and the total capacitance downstream of that, or we can think of each capacitance and the shared resistance on every path leading from the source to the destination passing through that capacitance. Okay? What we want to do is see if we can generalize this formula. Okay? And this was done in a paper way back in about 1958 or so, or somewhere in the 50s, by a person by name Elmore. And so the formula is called Elmore's formula. Right? So what does this say? The first thing is, you have to put a restriction on the kind of RC network that you are looking at. Okay? So the first restriction that we put is, the type of RC network that we are looking at is a tree structured RC network. right? What is a tree structure? There is a starting point, then there are branches. This is an example of a tree. Okay? In general, in computer science, this is a data structure which is used in order to store certain kinds of data. In terms of an electrical network, effectively what it means is each of these intersection points is a node in the network, and the branches correspond to some circuit element. Okay? In our case, the branches are all resistors. Every node, that is the intersection point between branches, has a capacitor going to ground. Okay? One further thing which sort of comes from the definition of this being a tree structure itself is to see that there are no loops allowed. Right? So no loop, nothing of this sort. Where there are sort of two branches diverging out and then converging back in. That's not permitted. What Elmore's formula says is, for this kind of a structure, you define a unique input and the destination or endpoint. Right? So there is some starting point, Vi, and some ending point, Vo. The delay between Vi and Vo is given by summation over all the capacitances into R, or I call this Tk, R I to k, where this R I to k is the shared capacitance between the path from Vi to Vo and Vi to Vk. That is the kth node. Shared resistance, sorry, thank you. Okay? So, right now I am just giving this as a formula. Okay? What does it mean? That if you have some complex tree structure, like that branching structure shown on the top over there, and one clearly defined input, Vi, one clearly defined output, Vo, and you have all these other capacitances which are there at intermediate nodes. Okay? The delay from Vi to Vo is going to be given by, you take all the capacitances in this circuit, right? And each capacitance you multiply by the shared resistance between that capacitance and the final destination. Okay? So now, the important thing to understand is, because this is a tree, right? There is only one possible path from the input to any node inside. Okay? There is precisely one way of reaching any intermediate node from that input node. Okay? So this shared resistance that we are talking about, which is the total resistance on the path from input to final output, intersection the resistance from the input to the kth capacitance, that is a uniquely defined value. Okay? It can be directly computed from the tree structure. Once you have that shared resistance, you multiply by the capacitance on that kth node. You do this for all the capacitances in the circuit. And you will find the delay from the input to the output. Okay? This will change if you change the output node. If I choose some other node as the output, the shared resistances, the shared paths will all change. Which means that the value that you calculate will also change. So it's uniquely defined given the input and given one particular output. Okay, given that combination, you can uniquely define what is the shared resistance and hence the delay too. Okay? Apply this to the previous case. Ri to 1, right? The shared resistance between the input and node 1 is just R1. Ri to 2 equals R1 plus R2. Okay, so total delay is R1 C1 plus R1 plus R2 into C2. Right? Let's take a slightly more complex network. Three capacitors and choosing the node 3 as VO, the output. Okay? So for C1, I need to calculate Ri to 1. What is it? R1. For C2, what is C2? It is a capacitance which is not on the direct path between the input and the output. Right? But in spite of that, because of the fact that there is that R1 which is common to the path between the destination and C2, some of the current which flows through R1 will get diverted to charge C2. Okay? What is the shared resistance Ri2? It's again R1. What about C3? This is our final destination. So Ri3 is R1 plus R3. Okay? And the overall delay becomes tau equals R1 into C1 plus R1 into C2 plus R1 plus R3 into C3. Apply this in the context of something like the 3 input NAND gate. The 3 input NAND gate, okay? The pull down network here is going to be V3. The sizes of the transistor have to be 3 V3. which means R by 3. The capacitance at this point is going to be, how much is it? It's going to be from the PMOS transistor, that will be 2+2+2, and from the NMOS, that is 3, so 9C. At this point it is 3C, and at this point also it is 3C. Okay? So effectively our circuit looks something like this. R by 3, 3C, R by 3, 3C, R by 3 and 9C. So what is the RC time constant due to just the parasitic alone? Of course the load capacitance will contribute another R into CL, right? But that has nothing to do with this. Due to the parasitic, it is going to be R by 3 into 3C. Sorry, 3C, not 3 by 3. This one will contribute 2R by 3 into 3C, and this one will contribute 3R by 3 into 9C. Okay, this means RC plus 2RC plus 9RC, 12RC instead of the 9RC that you would have normally calculated. Okay? So by assuming that we are sort of neglecting the intermediate node capacitances, we were making an underestimate of the delay. Right? We were being optimistic. We were saying that the delay is actually less than what it will be in practice. In reality, this additional thing has to be taken into account. Okay? Now, this is not the only place where the Elmore delay formula comes into effect in the LSI design. One of the most important places is in the context of large, long wires. Right? The most sort of crucial example of this is the so-called clock tree, which is used in order to distribute the clock signal across the entire circuit. Right? So instead of going into the full analysis of what a clock tree looks like, what I am going to do is take up the case of a specific wire. Right? And let's just consider what impact this Elmore delay formula has on the delay through a wire. Okay? So to understand that a bit more carefully, what you need to do is take a look at what does a wire in a VLSI circuit or a integrated circuit look like. Okay? It's drawn on some metal layer and in general it has some kind of a long structure like this. Right? Underneath it is going to be some kind of insulation. This means in turn that this is going to act like a capacitance. Right? Every segment of the wire, every piece of the wire is looking something like a parallel plate, because it has some insulating layer under it and then it has the bulk. So there is going to be some kind of a capacitive effect between those two. Right? Similarly, there is also going to be some resistance simply because every conductor has a resistance. Right? There is no question of getting a sort of pure ideal conductor. Even if you use gold, it will have some resistance associated with it. If you are using something like copper, then yes, it will be, the resistance will be more than that of gold, not very high, but still not negligible. Apart from that, there will be some segments where you are not even using copper, you might be using polysilicon or some other conductive material which has an even higher resistance than the copper. Okay? And more importantly, these copper strips that you are talking about are extremely narrow. These are microns that we are talking about over here. Right? Very thin strips of copper, which means that the resistance per unit length is going to be something non-trivial. The narrower it is, the higher the resistance. Okay? So, if I take a long wire, I can model it in two ways. One is the so-called lump model, where I take the total resistance of the wire, right, and the total capacitance of the wire, and multiply those together. The second approach is to say, I will take the distributed model where I will consider small r to be resistance per unit length of the wire. Another way of saying this is to say, break the wire into n segments so the resistance through one segment is capital R, the total R divided by n. Okay, these are pretty much the same way of saying it. For n tending to infinity, this is what we have, right? It becomes a continuous model. Similarly, I can also consider the small c, right, as the capacitance per unit length. Why does this work? Because the actual capacitance is going to be some epsilon by d times the area. The area of cross section under the wire is going to be its cross section multiplied by its length. Okay? So the longer the wire, the greater the capacitance. Right? So what we are saying is, we will divide by that length and consider the per unit length capacitance. Or alternately, capital C divided by N. Okay? So effectively what this is saying is that the wire actually looks something like this. There's one R, there's one C, small r, small t, etc. Broken into n segments. Right? With understanding that n into small r equals capital R, n into small t equals capital T. Okay? So, the question, is there any difference what will happen if I consider this distributed model versus the continuous model? Will I get any difference in the delay? If I use the distributed model, how I calculate the delay? N into? Sorry? Elmore formula. Okay? So, what happens in the case of this distributed network is that obviously I have built up to it through the entire class. So, you are going to use Elmore formula to find out what the delay through the overall network is. Right? Let's write that down. What will be the delay through the overall network? The first capacitance. What is the shared resistance on that path? R. Okay? So, it's going to be C into R. The second capacitance, what is the shared resistance? 2R. Third is going to be 3R. Until the final one becomes N times R. Okay? Take out C into small r as a common factor, you get 1 plus 2 plus 3 up to N. This is equal to N into N plus 1 by 2. Now for very large values of n, which is the case that we are considering as n tends to infinity, n into n plus 1 by 2 is approximately n square by 2. Okay? Which I can rewrite as t into n times r into n by 2, which is capital R into capital C by C. So you see what happens. Once we use Elmore's formula and do a slightly more accurate calculation of the delay through a long wire, right, we find that our lumped element approximation, which is to say I will take the total resistance, total capacitance, RC, that is double of what it actually should be. Okay, so the delay which you get by taking total R and total C is a major overestimate, being very pessimistic. Okay, so that's one important point to take away from this particular interpretation of Elmore's formula. Right, there is also another part of it which comes over here. Another way of writing this is to go back and look at this expression itself. Supposing I have a wire of some length L and I increase the length slightly. Okay? That's as good as saying I am adding on more segments. Okay? Or in other words, N is proportional to the length of the wire. If I take the small r and small c to be for some unit size, right, which means that tau is proportional to L square. Okay, so for a longer wire, because after all the resistance and capacitance are going to be constant per unit dimensions, right, unit length. Okay. So for a longer wire, the delay through the wire increases quadratically. It's not just a linear increase. It depends on both the R and the C, and it increases quadratically as a result of it. Right? Now that comes about even if you just take the R and C itself, right? Because the total R and total C will also go quadratically, or rather the R and the C product will go quadratically. But this one also says that there is a by 2 factor which comes into it. So, this kind of a structure is then used for analysis. There are a number of other places also where this kind of tree structure comes into existence, right? One, as I said, is the so-called slop tree, there will be one signal which I will break into two. That in turn will again be broken into two. Once again be broken into two. And finally the new flip flop connected at this one. Okay? Which means that there is some kind of a tree structure from the clock input to each flip flop. Okay? And finding the delay on that path also requires application of the Elmore formula. Okay? So that part of it I'm not going to go into right now. Clock distribution in general we'll sort of take a look at it a bit later. Depending on time, if time permits, we will sort of look into that in a bit more detail. But the important point is Elmore formula is used in all of these contexts in order to find the delay to a circuit. Okay? Alright, we'll stop here for now. Please keep in mind the day after tomorrow is the exam. Right? Hopefully the tutorial session on Friday was useful to get all your doubts clear. If you have any other doubts, please contact me or the TA today or tomorrow. Preferably not too late, don't leave it in too late. Okay? And as far as the portion itself is concerned, the part that we are doing today and tomorrow is not on the quiz, but everything else up to Friday is definitely going to be on the quiz.